Good afternoon. Thank you so much. Good afternoon and welcome to the final round. We made it to the final round of the Roger Voisin Memorial Trumpet Competition. Thank you all so much for coming. This has been a very exciting weekend for us all. We've heard some incredible playing, and that's not going to stop right now. It's going to get even more incredible. We're so excited. I'd like to take a moment. Oh, there I am. Did you hear anything I just said? It was so sincere and sweet. Did you hear? Oh, okay, good. Because I couldn't repeat it. It was so from the heart. But since, you know, sincerely, I would like to take this opportunity, as I have all weekend and will forever, to thank Douglas and Susan Kay for their generous donation that has made this incredible weekend possible. They are just the sweetest people who have made our dreams come true, and we thank you wholeheartedly. Thank you. And also thanks to Peter Voisin and the whole Voisin family for all of their support. They sent pictures and record covers, and they've helped us so much, you know, learned so much more than we ever knew about Roger Voisin. Peter is going to come in between the six selections that you'll hear. He will come up and he will say a few words about his father and show a wonderful video for you to enjoy. So we're really, really looking forward to that. We started as 35 applicants, and it was very difficult. We brought them down to eight. Eight were here yesterday playing their hearts out, and we have now brought it down to three. The best of the best. They are absolutely incredible. I cannot wait to hear them. The way this will work, as you can see in your program, is there'll be three movements, one each competitor of a classical concerto. Peter Voisin will speak, and then three movements of French contemporary concerti. It's going to be very exciting. When it is all over, we will meet in the lobby. There will be refreshments. Please join us. The judges will deliberate, and we will announce the winners out in the lobby. So again, thank you so much for being here. Please enjoy.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. That was a beautiful A. My name is Peter Voisin, and I am one of Roger Voisin's many students. I would like to welcome all of you to Lynn University and also to the Voisin extended family. You are now chez Voisin. Roger's mission was to serve music, and he did. Lynn University's mission is to be innovative, international, and individualized. Both Roger and Lynn University believe in those same values. This is why the Voisin family endorses this competition. My father was innovative. He started brass ensemble, edited and transcribed Baroque music for trumpet, established a publishing collaboration with Robert King Music Company, produced 5 Cap records of music trumpet albums, taught hundreds of students, and hosted Thanksgiving dinners for students who could not get back home for their holidays, gave his trumpets to his students and to Boston University after he retired from teaching. He was international. Came to Boston in 1927 at the age of 9 from Angers, France. Became the youngest member of the Boston Symphony in 1935 and played next to many musicians of many other countries from around the world for 38 years. He served in the Navy during World War II for the US State Department with a chamber orchestra using music as a language to bring nations together. He held a dual citizenship, United States and France, served on several international trumpet competition committees, traveled the world both with the Boston Symphony and with his wife Martha throughout his life. And Roger was individualized. Roger had a unique gift of understanding his colleagues, his students, and patrons by listening, observing, and dialoguing with them. Being French, the individualization gene runs strong in his culture and ethnicity. But Roger thought that everyone should pursue their individualization to find their best. His philosophy of being individual was something that he believed was the common denominator that was shared with everyone he met. Before I conclude, I would like to thank the orchestra, our 3 finalists, and our 3 judges for an amazing afternoon of music. Thank you. All of you have your own story of growing up between the ages of 9 and 17. I certainly do. Roger and I did some interviews together in 2004 and 2005 before his passing in 2008. And it was done just for this very moment before us. After listening to his story, continue to enjoy the rest of this historic competition and support the Lynn Conservatory of Music and its fabulous symphony orchestra. Thank you.
You and your family came over to Boston, and I think it was, and just correct me, in 1927, and you were a boy. Tell us about that trip and what you can remember about.
Not very much, because I don't know if that's a good memory, but I do remember that we came either tourist class or something like that. And I remember that my father, we came late because he had some commitments in Paris. So we were met at New York by the bassoon player called Boaz Piller, who used to be like the ambassador of the Boston Symphony Orchestra.
Yeah.
And the only thing, I don't remember too much about the trip. The only thing I remember, one night I wanted to see John Wayne, and it was a very bad night. I mean, the sea was rough, and there was absolutely nobody for the movie. And I'm not a very good sailor, but that night I wasn't sick because I wanted to see John
Wayne.
Wanted
to see John Wayne.
So I remember seeing that, but the thing that shocked us more than anything else is that when you, I don't know if you know, but when you get out of a Grand Central, you get out around 90th Street or something like that, and you're in the back of a kind of a popular neighborhood, And at the back was hanging all sorts of laundry. So our introduction to America wasn't a golden pavement, you know, it was that laundry hanging it, you know, along the railroad tracks.
Golly. Wow, so you came over then when you were 9 years old, and then between the ages of 9 and age 17, you grew up, because that's when I believe you joined the Boston Symphony.
Right.
So what were you doing to get into the Boston Symphony over those years?
Well, first of all, the first thing that, as you know, in Europe, you don't just pick up an instrument. They expect you to be able to read music. So I had some solfeggio lesson for at least a year with a fellow by the name of Gaston Dufresne, who was a member of the Boston Symphony Orchestra, an excellent musician, a double bass player, former cornet player, and what we call première médaille de solfège at the conservatoire. At first medaille, first prize of solfeggio. And he was teaching more or less all the children of the musicians, you see, and they would go to Dufresne.
Now, solfège is not something that is an American.
Well, we think it's French, but I think we stole it from the Italian. Oh. I think it's really solfeggio.
Solfeggio.
And it's the art of reading music, giving syllables, do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, si, do,
okay,
to music, and to be able to, it's the alphabet of music, you see. And so we feel in Europe, we're not that rich that, you know, little Johnny can go rent a clarinet, you know, and start tooting away on his clarinet. They want us to know our solfeggio, our music. So that's the normal way to go. You learn your solfeggio, you learn how to read music, not to be a composer or something, just to be able to look at a piece of music and be able to say do, mi, re, fa, mi, fa, fa, to be able to do this. And I had that for at least a year before I touched an instrument. Then my father permitted me to play, and I started on the cornet, I started on the B-flat cornet. But I have to tell you, my first solfeggio lesson with my adored teacher, Gaston Dufresne, because it was, first of all, he petrified everybody. He was unbelievably strict and everything. And I'll never forget that. I mean, I had prepared my first lesson. So I said, do, re, mi, fa, sol, mi, do, re, mi, fa, sol, and he said, quoi? Qu'est-ce que c'est que ça? And I was frozen, absolutely. Qu'est-ce que tu me fais? And I said, I didn't know, you know, I was just reading it. He said, mais il faut que j'entende le soupir. I have to hear the rest. Well, there was no rest, you know, there is do, by me, fa, sol. I said, le rest, oui, c'est pour do, by me, c'est do, by me, fa, sol, mi, do. See, he wanted to hear the space.
Subdivision.
In between the notes, which creates the rhythm. And it's absolutely true.
Oh my God.
It's not around.
Yes.
You see, it's
yes.
Not around. It is, and while I was instilled with that, right from the very first lesson.
Wow.
My very first lesson. So I mean, I have good solfeggio. You can hear my soupir, the same rhythm, in between the notes.
In between the notes. And your father then was the one that taught you?
He started me off, which was very unusual, for the simple reason that usually the trumpet player sends his son to the trombone player, and the trombone player sends his son to the trumpet player.
Okay.
And but in my case, first of all, not only did I respect my father, but as you know, it's oui papa, non papa, there's no fooling around. And so papa,
oui papa,
oui papa, oui papa, oui papa gave me, you know, gave me lessons. And
believe me, I know what you're talking
about. I wonder why. No, no, so he was really, and he was a wonderful, wonderful teacher, and what an advantage is to have somebody like this.
And you had lessons, what, once a week?
Every day. I had a lesson because I lived near the school.
Okay.
And I had lunch at home, and then I had about half an hour lunch, and for half an hour I would be able, I practiced a little bit more after school, and then my father would come home, then I would have a lesson. So, in other words, I never went one day without being corrected. In other words,
oh my gosh.
I did not get any bad habits because I wasn't.
You had a couple of hours to get a bad habit, right?
Absolutely, yes, wow. Absolutely.
That's amazing. And so you basically, Jen, then went to school and studied, and then did your grandfather basically get you into the Boston Symphony or get you the audition? Or
my father, you did.
I'm sorry, your father, right.
My father.
Right.
No, what happened is that about 3-4 years in, I was, at that time I was maybe 12 or something like that, 13, 14 or something. My father, you know, we have not, we trumpet players or we brass players, not all of us are going to be Maurice Andre, so we know that we're going to land in an orchestra somewhere. So
okay.
There's unfortunately, and even now they have what you call like community orchestras,
mm-hmm,
or something
sure.
like that. Mm-hmm. And just at that time, Arthur Fiedler, who was in the Boston Symphony, was there as a viola player and as a celestial player, started to conduct a little bit. Excuse me, he got a lot of experience conducting. He had a little sinfonietta, but he had something called the McDowell Club, which was an orchestra in Boston, which was considered of both students and, you know, doctors and
mm-hmm.
lawyers
mm-hmm.
and something like that. And so what he did, excuse me, what he did was he get me to, yeah, I think we have to stop. Get a minute.
Okay, so. Yeah, that's true. Okay,
so
on.
As I was saying,
okay,
I started with the McDowell Club, which was conducted by Arthur Fiedler.
Right.
McDowell Club was being a community orchestra.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And so I played about, I was 14, 15, 16 with Fiedler. And then by that time, Fiedler became conductor of the Pops. And so you were asking me a little while ago if my father helped me in the Boston Symphony.
Right.
Not at all. My father absolutely, absolutely disagreed, completely disapproved strongly that I, because what happened? We were non-union,
right.
And you only played by invitation. And Arthur Fiedler once announced to me, you know that your trumpet player, your third trumpet is leaving, Monsieur Grandel. I said, yes, I know that. He says, well, I want you to play for Kusevitsky, there'll be an opening. He says, you want me to play? Absolutely. And I'm gonna get you a rendezvous with Kusevitsky. And of course, I came home, I told my father, that's an idiot, absolutely idiot. They thought, you don't know anything about you know how to play the trumpet, you're not gonna. Well, Arthur Fiedler did care. He got me an audition, and I had an audition with Kusevitsky and with all the first chairmen, and I wasn't even 17 because I had just, I was going to turn 17 because my audition was just before June. And I was born in June,
yes.
And I was 16.
So you were still 16?
16, and before the Pop started.
Mm-hmm.
And Fiedler was my champion. He's the one that got me to play for Kusevitsky.
That's unbelievable.
And my father almost got in trouble because one, they said, yes. Well, first of all, Kusevitsky was very smart. He, I wonder why Fiedler pushed me so much, you know. And he said, well, if he's that good, he said, I like it, but if he's that good, will you let him play first at Pops? The Pops was coming in 3 days or something. And that's a big job. First trumpet at Pops is a big job.
Yes.
And Arthur said, sure, well, Arthur knew me. He's known me for 3 years.
Right.
I did. And then Kusiewiczki said, well, if he does all right at Pops, let me know and we'll take him in October. At that time, the Boston Symphony season started the first week of October.
I see.
And so that backed up. And my father was absolutely, to the point that it took him 3 days to say yes. And nobody, you know, didn't know what to do with my father. And then by that time, Kusiewiczki was starting to get mad. And it was not a good idea to
get Kusiewiczki mad.
And so I think LaFrance and people like that said, well, René, you know, do something. And so we have a very wonderful man in the Boston Symphony whose name was Fernand Gillet. He was our first oboe player.
Gillet.
And Fernand Gillet was so refined and he was so distingué or something that we Frenchmen called him l'anglais, we called him the Englishman. And he wasn't English at all.
He was refined.
He was very, really an impeccable musician. Mm-hmm. And so Fernand Gillet went to talk to my father and said, René, we know he doesn't know anything, this and that, but you're here, this and that, and you know, Kusiewiczki really would like him or something like that. So he finally said, okay. And that's how I get it. My father was, as I say, he didn't help me at all. And he was right, because I didn't know what, in French we have a word we call le métier, and it's all the job, you know, ballet, opera, and all this. It's not just playing your tune to tune, you know, and then doing this.
Thank you. Ha 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 ha!